Welcome to OTN Community Cast here at TDC Florianapolis 2016. And we have with us today Edson Yanaga, Java champion. Thank you, Edson, for coming on board.
Yeah, thank you, Javed.
All right. So you gave a presentation today. I guess we can talk a little bit about that later. But first of all, what does it take to be a Java champion?
Oh, that's an interesting question. Uh-huh. Because I've worked with Java for since I was like 16. Uh-huh. So it has been many years working with Java. Uh-huh. And ever since I heard about the Java Champions program, I always wondered, oh, maybe someday, who knows, I'll be able to deserve the title to do something enough. Uh-huh. And that was something that I chased for many years when I was younger.
Uh-huh.
But the interesting point is that it's kind of hard to be a Java champion because uh-huh. that's a community-driven program, and there are so few Java champions in the world.
Uh-huh.
So in some point of my life, I just gave up on chasing this title.
Uh-huh.
But
the first lesson for our viewers: never give up. Go ahead.
But
it is success.
But I think the point is when I started worrying less about getting the title and uh-huh. worrying more about contributing to the community uh-huh. and doing more to help others instead of helping myself,
uh-huh.
I think that got me closer to the title.
Yeah.
So and it also made me happier because, you know, when you have community, when you help others,
uh-huh.
I don't know how that's something amazing because sure. you feel very well yes. when something that you say or a demo that you do uh-huh. on an article or video that uh-huh. you publish, when that small piece of information, when that's valuable to someone,
uh-huh.
when it helps someone,
uh-huh.
and years or months uh-huh. later, when some of these people come to you and say, oh, thank you very much for that thing, it uh-huh. helped me, it saved my day.
Yes.
Oh, that's one of the most rewarding feelings that you can have in your life.
Right.
And when I started to help each other and worry more about others than me,
uh-huh.
I think that's got me closer to this achievement.
Sure.
I was always worried about I wanted to deserve that instead of having the title.
Great.
And I hope that I've reached the point of I earn it.
Great. So I think what one thing I kind of take away from that is, as in any community, it's looking for the common good. And if you take care of the common good, it comes to pay you back.
Yes, instead, everybody knows that there are some kinds of people in the community that are just looking for self-promotion.
Uh-huh.
I think that's the wrong way to achieve something.
Uh-huh.
And when you just try to help each other, it makes everything much easier because you're just building friends and relationships.
Uh-huh.
That's an amazing part of being part of the community,
uh-huh.
and especially about the Java community, because I'm very grateful to be able to say that I have hundreds of thousands of friends all around the world.
Mm-hmm.
And the Java is the thing that got all of us connected.
Great. Well, it's become almost kind of a universal language.
Instead of choosing English or Portuguese or Japanese, uh-huh. we cannot talk Java and everybody understands everything.
All right. So how do things look with Java Enterprise? I mean, I know we were talking a little bit earlier about you've got kind of two worlds. One is the kind of the monolithic world, and then you've got the world of microservices and containers and the trend in that direction. So share a little bit about that in terms of that trend that's going on.
Sure. I've been talking and thinking a lot about microservices lately, and I think it's kind of a mistake because microservices is the current hype. Everybody wants to be doing microservices. Everybody's studying microservices. But many people don't realize that maybe we have great examples of microservices in the world. Amazon does that. Netflix does that. But maybe not everybody needs to be Amazon or Netflix. Not everybody needs to do the way they do. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, we, most of our Java developers, we are we work at enterprise shops. We have current systems. We have that now we call legacy. We have to maintain that. And when I say legacy, I don't say that in a bad way, because legacy for me is something that is generating value
mm-hmm.
and something that has to be maintained.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a Java EE monolith. It's generating value. But maybe we want to have take some of the benefits of using microservices into production.
Mm-hmm.
So why can't we keep some parts of both worlds mm-hmm. into our systems? So what I've been working lately is how can we take our Java EE monolith and split some parts of that on some microservices
mm-hmm.
so that we can have a distributed architecture but still keeping that core of the system as a Java EE application, because, you know, just as COBOL, Java EE will be around for the next 50 years.
Okay.
And it will be the core.
People take note, the next 50 years.
Yeah, at least. I'm pretty sure we're all going to retire and Java EE systems will be still be running. So since the Java EE application will still be the core of this system, we have to take good care of that. So, but we also want to use some microservices into production because sometimes it makes sense. Sometimes we have a different kind of business domain that we want to split and we want to implement in a different technology. We can run Spring Boot, Wild Flash Swarm, Node.js, or anything else that can run into a microservice. And we want to integrate all of that with our core business using Java EE. I think that's the most typical scenario that most enterprise shops will be running in the next years. We have a big monolith, and we have some microservices around this big monolith, monolith coexisting in a beautiful architecture.
And the world will live happily ever after. So I think a key lesson there, again, not to throw out the baby with the bathwater, Java EE has a lot of a great future ahead, but again, with all the transitions and with all the, some of the newer technologies from containers and microservices, opportunities to kind of leverage Java EE in these new environments.
Sure, because I think there's a misconception because some people believe that Java EE equals monoliths and other technologies means microservices, other technologies are more lightweight. But that's not the case because currently we're talking about the real deployment artifact that we get into production is containers. If you have a container, anything that's packaged inside the container, doesn't matter what is inside. You can have a full application server running with your war inside, and you can have anything else running inside a container. They're all the same in the deployment perspective. So that's an independent deployment artifact. You can scale it independently. You can deploy it independently. You can maintain it independently. So if you have containers, you can still use Java EE inside that container. Because Java EE is a mature technology. We have different libraries, different aspects that we're still discussing. The Netflix stack is a very good example of that. We have some innovation happening, but Netflix stack is Java 2. You can integrate Java Netflix stack into Java EE. You can have the same benefits of other technologies inside Java EE.
Right.
So you just don't throw away 20 years of knowledge and innovation and running systems into productions just out of the window just because we have microservices now. We can still do microservices with Java EE.
Okay, wonderful. Well, thank you so much for not only giving us hope, but for sharing.
Okay. Yeah, sure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Have a good one. Yeah.